everyone, and welcome back to the channel. My name's Jenny. Today we're going to be talking about one of my favorite species of reptile, the diamondback terrapin. Now these animals are beautiful and fascinating and fun to take care of, but they also have interesting biology, ecology, and conservation history. So we're going to be talking about those guys today in conjunction with another channel, the Turtle Girl. So the Turtle Girl is really knowledgeable and she goes in depth in her videos into all aspects of turtle care. So I'll have a link in the description of this video to her video about diamondback terrapin care. And so when you're done watching this video, be sure to hop on over to her channel, check it out. I guarantee you're gonna love it. Now, diamondback terrapins have one of the largest ranges of any North American turtle. They are found all the way from Maine down to Florida, and even in Bermuda too. And they live, as I said before, in brackish water. If you don't know, brackish is a mixture of freshwater and saltwater. And they really like to be in the zone where it's not too fresh or too salty. And though they will live in freshwater, and they can also live in saltwater, they just prefer to live in brackish water, which is that sort of zone of mixture between the two. So as I said, they do prefer to live in brackish water, but in captivity they can live in fresh water. But they actually can live in full strength salt water for some extended periods of time. And one of the ways that they can accommodate this type of salinity in their environment is a lacrimal salt gland. They have these salt glands in their eyes that help extrude extra salt from their body. Sort of like sea turtles. If you're aware of sea turtles sort of crying, they do the same thing. And their skin is also pretty much impermeable to salt in their environment. Now these turtles really love being in the water and they're very strong swimmers. They have strongly webbed feet that help propel them through the water and a sort of flattened shell that helps streamline them as they move through the water. So the name diamondback terrapin actually refers to their carapace. If you look at the carapace of a diamondback terrapin, you're going to see these sort of concentric shapes on their scutes. And sometimes they can look diamond-like, sometimes they can look sort of like other shapes, but that's where they get that name diamondback terrapin from. Now, one thing I love about diamondback terrapins is that their colors can vary really widely between individuals. And in this species, there are actually 7 subspecies. Here where I live in Georgia, we typically find the Carolina diamondback terrapin. But there's also the Texas diamondback terrapin, the ornate diamondback terrapin, the Mississippi diamondback terrapin, the mangrove diamondback terrapin, the eastern Florida diamondback terrapin, and also the northern diamondback terrapin. Now, one thing that I find really cool about diamondback terrapins is that there are only native species of reptile that lives its entire life in salt marshes and estuaries. Other species of reptiles like alligators and cottonmouths may go into brackish water sometimes, but they don't want to live in it 24/7. So after mating occurs in the spring, females will seek out sand dunes and lay between 4 to 22 eggs in late summer. Around 60 to 85 days after the eggs are laid, the babies hatch, and they usually tend to go off on their own, but some may overwinter if it's a particularly cold area. So as far as their diet goes, they're predators in the wild, and they love to eat fish, mussels, clams, crabs, shrimp. Periwinkle snails are a big part of their diet too, fiddler crabs, especially where I live, there's lots of fiddler crabs here on the Georgia coast. And something kind of interesting about their impact on the ecosystem is that if they can eat enough periwinkle snails, it tends to help out the spartina grass in marshes because periwinkle snails will graze heavily on the spartina grass, which is the main plant in a marsh. And so diamondback terrapins help to control the snail population, which in turn helps the grass population, which then in turn helps the marsh ecosystem. Now, as far as their conservation history goes, terrapins have kind of a sad story in that about 100 years ago, turtle soup, or also called terrapin soup, was incredibly popular. And it was so popular that they were considered a delicacy. And in 1917, a diamondback terrapin could go for as much as $5. Now, I plugged $5 into an inflation calculator online, and in 1917, that $5 would be roughly equivalent to around $104 in today's money. So as time has gone on, marsh and coastal areas have become more popular for development, for housing, and for retail areas. And so diamondback terrapins lose this habitat to development every year. And the issue is that they prefer that brackish water habitat, like I was saying before. So they won't move inland to more freshwater habitat as their marsh coastal areas become more developed. So over time, they lose these areas that they would normally use for hunting, for breeding, and for laying their nests in. While unfortunately diamondback terrapins don't have any federal conservation protection, individual states tend to have conservation laws protecting these animals. Here in my state, Georgia, they are protected under state law, but they're not considered endangered or threatened. They're listed as a species of concern. Now, despite not having federal protection status here in the United States, and these individual states giving varying degrees of protection under their state laws, the IUCN, which is the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, actually lists these animals as near threatened because of their falling population numbers. Now, besides habitat loss and overhunting for food, diamondback terrapins also face pressure from deaths in crab traps that have been abandoned. So when crab traps are abandoned, these are called ghost traps. Diamondback terrapins can get caught inside these traps, not be able to get out, and then they die under the water. Now, one thing that's happening lately is crab traps are being retrofitted with turtle exclusion devices, or TEDs, and this helps the diamondback terrapin have a way to get out of these traps without affecting the actual capture of the crabs for these crab fishermen. Now, as far as predators go, adult diamondback terrapins in the wild tend to have almost no natural predators. Now, let's say an alligator got into the marsh, yeah, he might eat a terrapin, but typically they are pretty safe once they're adults from predation from other animals. But when they're babies, they actually do have a lot of predators, including gulls, crows, foxes, raccoons, opossums, raiding nests, things like that. And besides predation on the nests and the hatchlings by predators like raccoons, terrapins also face impacts from cars as well. So road mortality is an impact on their populations fairly heavily in the areas where females go onto land to go lay their nests. And down near where I live, Jekyll Island, is one of the places where they have signs up along the causeway out to the island saying to be cautious, of turtles crossing the road.
You had some good scoots coming off now, girl. Shit, you can't tell them when they're telling until they're dried out. At the Tybee Island Marine Science Center, we have a hatchling head start program for the diamondback terrapin. The diamondback terrapin is a great conservation measure for us in the state of Georgia because we have so much abundant salt marsh. This is their sole habitat. They're the only reptile in the salt marsh, and so in the state of Georgia, we protect them readily in the state. So at the Tybee Island Marine Science Center, we exhibit diamondback terrapins. We also head start those diamondback terrapins in the spring. And summer, we ordinarily get many hatchlings through our turtle rescue. Those hatchlings can be found displaced in their habitat. So we abut the salt marsh here on Tybee Island, and so we have a lot of hatchlings that are coming out after bromation. They will exit from underground, and they'll end up in swimming pools, at the beach, at the post office. And so this hatchling that's displaced, we will accept through turtle rescue, and then we will head start that hatchling for about a year until it reaches 5 to 8 centimeters. And that's about the size of a fist. And that just allows them a little bit of a better chance of survival. This is an adult diamondback terrapin. So Miss Pearl here is one of our permanent residents. We also have another adult. So they're both over 10 years old. Miss Ruby is the other diamondback terrapin that we have on display here. So two adults and then rotating hatchlings. So these two are examples of diamondback terrapin hatchlings. So like I first mentioned, we have displaced hatchlings that might end up in a swimming pool. So we will hydrate them and then display them for about 1 year until they're 5 to 8 centimeters. Another way that we can accept a diamondback terrapin is if we get a hit female through our turtle rescue. On Tybee Island, we have a causeway that accesses the island that cuts the salt marsh right in two. And so we get during nesting season, which is May and June, we'll get a lot of female diamondback terrapins that will come onto the causeway. When they enter the causeway, they're looking for high ground to nest, and often they'll get hit during So we have a lot of dead-on-road individuals. There's a study going on within the state to kind of survey the amount of hatchlings, and preliminary studies are showing that about 120 females are getting hit every season. So she's going to nest about every couple weeks, and she'll have a clutch of 7 to 11 eggs in her body. So if she gets hit and has already nested, then that's a loss for the future of her nesting abilities. But if she gets hit with eggs, that's when we can step in. We'll accept that turtle, and if she is already dead on road, we can bring her back to the science center and do an eggectomy. This is an extraction of her eggs. Those eggs are viable at room temperature for a couple hours, and so that allows us to be able to remove the eggs from her oviduct, and then we can incubate them at the local university. Dr. Craven at Armstrong has a program where she studies diamondback terrapin hatchlings, and so she'll incubate them for size studies and for gender studies.
Oh, she's so pretty. This is Pearl.
Pearl.
And
she's then Ruby's
so
on display still.
Ruby's not happy that Pearl is out.
She's like, where did
she
go?
Like looking at me.
That's so cute.
Oh,
so
baby.
She's like, where did she go?
Are they fairly friendly towards each other, or
at this young age, they pick on one, so one will kind of, you know, if it's smaller, will end up getting picked on and nipped at by its foot and its tail, so we've had that a lot. But Ruby and Pearl don't really bother each other at all.
Yeah.
It probably has to do with the fact that they've been in captivity a long time with each other.
Mm-hmm.
Also, perhaps them being adults is a difference as well.
Like
yeah, she's the
boss. Pearl out.
Yeah.
She'd be like a Dorothy if they were the Golden Girls.
How long have y'all had her?
So we have them on record for 2017, so in their 11th year here with us. Or 2007, sorry. So turtles in captivity, we help them shed their scutes. So I'm helping pull off those scutes. In nature, they would use a rough surface to naturally exfoliate those scutes. So each of these individual plaques are their scutes. It's made out of the same keratin as our hair and fingernail. And so what's quite beautiful when you take it off. And it comes off as a whole. Sea turtles aren't quite as uniform as these girls can be, but we kind of help them along, because if you don't, and if you keep them kind of loose and not fully pulled off, that allows for a lot of bacteria to kind of grow in the middle of those two surfaces. So we kind of help them along by pulling off scutes. And of course, you know, they're marginal scutes like these guys can peel off, but then also all of these plastron scutes. Just good husbandry, good shell health, and then we'll rub her down with some betadine, and then we will get her back in her tank. We do that about once a month, but we don't force the scutes, it's just whenever they're ready. And these are really nice and coming off nicely. They should lift easily. You don't want to force it, or else you're going to start, you know, tearing and causing bleeding to get their face in the water. Absolutely. We also trim their nails so that they're not, you know, scratching each other. They're because they'll grow exponentially. Ooh, that was a good one too, girl.
God, I love doing this.
I really agree.
Because I do this.
I know it's like not probably too different from like liking to peel a sunburn or something. Same school of like neurology. Very tolerant and very thankful. Usually I use a little tool, a little dissection tool.
Oh, okay.
But I have long nails right now and I don't ordinarily, and I tell you what, it helps a lot.
Alright guys, thank you so much for watching today. I hope you enjoyed this video on diamondback terrapins. Don't forget to head on over to the Turtle Girls channel, check out her video on diamondback terrapin care in captivity, and once again, thanks for watching. Tune in next time.